Hello everyone, this is Olivier from Techitron here again today, and we're bringing you our review of the Symphony Xplorer Z5 or Z5, whichever way you'd like to call it. Now the story behind the Xplorer Z5 is a little unique because the Xplorer Z4 didn't really work that well in the market. So what Symphony did is they took customer reviews and response and they tried to make the Z5 more of a consumer device. And the device is actually selling so well that it's currently out of stock. It retails for around 15,000 taka, and let's not waste any more time and get ready to review this.
As usual, we're going to start off with the design and build and hardware of this device. So for the Xplorer Z5, the build quality of this is actually one of highlighted aspects of the device, because it feels really strong and sturdy in the hand. It doesn't squeak, it doesn't feel like it's plasticky or weak, and that's something that's very good, especially for a device that costs around 15,000 taka. Now let's talk about the design of it, and as you can see, the Z5 is actually a pretty slim device. Now what I really like about the Z5 is that, if you can see around here, this edge, it has a certain angle to it. Now it may not seem like much, but whenever you hold it in the hand, it just feels absolutely great. It feels like it belongs in your hand, because for me the thumb actually rests right here, which is the sweet spot. Now I would like to point out some negatives of the design, and I think the first one would be that the back is non-removable. Now aside from that, you can also see the back is highly reflective and it catches fingerprints like crazy. Like if you just see me wipe my hand along, you can see the trail it left, and this, therefore the device requires constant, and I mean constant, wiping to make sure it just doesn't look disgusting. Now the front also has a similar problem, but I think that is mainly because of the screen protector. Taking a look at the side here, we have the volume up and down button, the power button, and the SIM card slot. Now the SIM card slot needs to be removed with a SIM ejector tool, but it is provided in the box and isn't much of a hassle. Around the bottom here, as you can see, we have two speaker grills, which I actually found a little difficult to believe they're independent speakers. I personally thought they were one speaker right here in the middle, or maybe a little towards this side, and the sound just got funneled through two speakers. But the point is, it's not on the back and it sounds pretty great. So whenever you keep it flat on a table, or maybe you're playing some games, it's not going to block the sound and it's going to look pretty good. On the left side of the device, we have the micro SD card slot, which again has to be removed with the SIM ejector tool provided inside the box. Now let's take a look at the top of the device, and as you can see, we have the micro USB port as well as the 3.5mm headset jack. Now this is a bit uncommon in devices. Usually you see the micro USB port on the bottom of the device, but I found this to be a very good convenience, because whenever I'm using the phone while it's charging, the wall and the charger is usually away from the device. So having it on the top really makes it a bit more convenient than having it on the bottom. And as usual, the 3.5mm headset jack, it's always convenient to have it on the top. It's a well-known thing. Another aspect of the device that I really like is this nice chamfered edge over here. Now, it's not like the things you find in some metallic phones, but it looks similar and it actually feels pretty good. Another point to mention on the backside is that the camera module is flush with the back, so nothing is protruding or anything. So you don't have to worry about getting the camera module scratched or whatever whenever you lay it down on the surface. Also, another good point about this is that it doesn't rock whenever you keep it on a table, so typing on a table or any other flat surface is pretty easy and it basically gets the job done. The front of the device is actually pretty bare bones, and as you can see, we have the camera module up top over here, the speaker over here, and the proximity and light and ambient sensors over there. Now another thing that we appreciate about the design of the device is that the bezels around the sides, they're pretty thin, and it's something that makes using the device in one hand very easy, because already the screen is 5 inches, but making the bezel thin limits the bulk of the device. Around the bottom bezel, we have capacitive keys, which unlike previous smartphones that we've seen, they're actually just three simple dots. I'm not sure if you can see this in the video, but right over here, these are 1, 2, 3 dots. A negative point about this is that the light intensity isn't very high, so you won't really be able to see the dots outdoors, but I think it adds a nice sense of elegance that the traditional Android keys don't provide on other capacitive keys in smartphones. Now let's talk about what we're going to be using the most on this device, and that is the display.
Now, the Xplorer ZV has a 5-inch 720p display. And the remarkable thing about this is that at first I did not think it was just an HD display. I in fact thought it was a full HD display, which is just a testament that goes to show that this device's display is pretty damn good. Now, what I really liked most about this device is that the color accuracy and the sharpness on the display are really good. Although the pixel density is just around 290 pixels per inch. Now, the quality of the display is especially seen whenever you're using high-res wallpapers, because everything looks very nice and sharp and colors just pop out, similar to what you'd actually expect from an AMOLED display, in fact. Although the blacks aren't as deep as you would find in AMOLED. But the main point here is that things just look very great and using the display is just a pleasure. Now, on the Xplorer ZV, we have a 1.4 GHz octa-core processor. Yes, you heard me correct, an octa-core processor, which has been backed up by 2 GB of RAM, as well as a Mali 450 GPU, which is more than enough to actually support the 720p resolution. Now, as you can see on the AnTuTu benchmark, the Xplorer ZV ranks just below the LG G3 and right above the original HTC One M7. And as we've seen before, this just goes to show the device performs really well. And it's expected when you have an octa-core processor along with 2 GB of RAM in the package. Now, the software experience on the ZV is very close to stock Android. In fact, the very few things that have been added here. We have Android 4.4.2 KitKat running the show, and as expected from KitKat, everything works nice and smoothly, and the frame rate's actually pretty high. Although you may think that the software looks like stock Lollipop, we're actually using Nova Launcher here, so the actual thing that you will get is an appearance of stock Android KitKat. So we just use Nova Launcher here just for the aesthetic appeal of this device. Although Symphony hasn't really added much to the software experience here, one very valuable thing that they have added is gesture control. Now, what you can do here is set certain gestures so that using the device just becomes easier. My favorite one is the double click to wake the device. So whenever you're powered off, just double tap on the device's screen and it's just going to wake up. And that's something that I really want on my own daily driver. So having it here and making it work so well is definitely a merit to this device. Another really handy gesture is the ability to launch the camera really quickly from the screen by just drawing a C. You can also do other things such as launch the web browser, the music player, etc., etc., and even configure your own applications to the gestures. Now, the device comes with 16 GB of built-in storage, which is expandable to up to 32 GB using the microSD card slot. When it comes to the battery life, we managed to get about a full days of use even when we're using the device intensely. And that's a bit surprising given that the battery is just a 2000 mAh unit. The camera on the Xplorer ZV is a 13 megapixel unit, and it is something that I really like personally. The front-facing unit is a 2 megapixel sensor, and it is adequate for taking selfies or maybe video conferencing. So we have certain modes such as live photo mode, and then a beauty shot mode, motion tracking, panorama, and even a multi-angle picture taking mode. And these are some standard features you'll find in most devices within this price range. What we really like about this camera is how zippy it is when taking photos. Aside from that, you also find a lot of detail in the images that are taken by the device, something that I haven't seen on sensors with the same amount of megapixels on other phones. So as you can see, we have a pretty good bit of detail. Aside from that, we have some features like HDR and also gesture capture, which works pretty well in selfie mode, but doesn't really do much whenever you're taking pictures with the main camera.
The Xplorer ZV has quite a lot of amazing features that you should consider. First of all, we have excellent battery life,